So yeah, before I get started, I'd just like to thank Johnson State College and the Behavioral Science Department for allowing me to spend my spring break here in Johnson, Vermont. And
well, I mean that wasn't a joke.
And so yeah, so thank you. And although the weather's been very cold, I would say my interaction with the faculty, staff, and students here has made me feel very warm. So thank you. And so as I start today off, I want to take a trip down memory lane. And I want to go back, not too far back, but just go back a little bit in time. Let's say 6 months. Roughly 6 months. This was a Monday night in September. Specifically, the date was September 26th. And this was the first presidential debate between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. Now, I know that was a very tumultuous time for some of us, so I'm not going to go into too much detail about the debate specifically. The one thing I did want to highlight was a comment or a question that was asked of him. So to refresh people's memory, that night, Larry Cole was the moderator during this talk, and he asked Hillary Clinton to comment on a statement that she had made a week prior. And this statement was, and this is verbatim, "We need to do everything possible to improve policing. We need to go right at implicit bias." So that's a statement that Hillary had made a week prior to this debate. Larry Cole asked Hillary to comment on that statement, and this is the question which he asked her. "Do you believe that police are implicitly biased against black people?" To which Hillary responded, "I think implicit bias is a problem for everyone, not just police. I think unfortunately too many of us in our great country jump to conclusions about each other." Now, I think it's safe to say, at least in my opinion, social psychologists were turning cartwheels in their living rooms once we spread this statement. And the reason why is that her comment moved to the forefront of the public conversation, an issue that social scientists have been discussing for a number of decades, specifically social psychologists. And this was implicit bias. Namely, this idea that even well-meaning people frequently have unconscious attitudes and unconscious bias towards members of certain racial groups, and that this bias can lead to a number of negative outcomes. Now, I think it bodes well, and many researchers would argue this as well, that the scientific findings of this research, it bodes well as making its way into the public discourse. However, their meanings and the implications need to be carefully understood, because when they're not, they can be easily misconstrued and mischaracterized and be presented a number of misinformation. So this is what happened shortly after this debate. After Hillary made these statements, major media outlets ran op-eds where they took Hillary's comments about implicit bias being an issue that impacts all Americans, and they framed it in a way in which Hillary Clinton was basically saying that all Americans in the United States were secretly racist. That was a way in which they're framing this research about implicit bias. And if you ask majority of the social psychologists that do research within this area, as I would argue, or they would argue, I should say, that's not what they're suggesting. They're not saying implicit bias is at all there. And so what I'm hoping to do today is hopefully dispel some of the myths centered around implicit bias that I think that a lot of the lay public is confused on. And so by doing that, I want to address this, or attempt to do this, by answering four main questions. First question is, why do we even have implicit biases? In other words, what's the root cause of our implicit biases? The second question, which I hope to try to bring some clarity on, is what is the cause of implicit racial bias? Now, we have many different biases, but given today I want to focus and center the talk on implicit racial bias, because that's my expertise, but we have biases tied to a number of different groups and a number of different situations. Third is, do these implicit biases even matter? So in other words, what are the consequences of the implicit racial biases that we have, and do they even matter? Lastly, I think something that's what can we do about it? So we have these implicit biases, we're answering these other questions, we'll end on what can we do about these implicit biases. So you heard the definition of implicit bias that Gina gave. I think it's very important that when talking about any construct, to provide a definition that it gives everybody an equal footing. And I'm saying implicit bias, Gina's saying implicit bias, and we're talking about two different things. This leads to some confusion around some of these concepts. So the definition in which I'm going to be grounding the work in which I'm talking about today and trying to address these questions is here. It refers to the attitudes or stereotypes that affect our understanding, actions, and decisions in an unconscious manner. Unconscious is molded and undermined because that is very important tied to this concept of implicit bias. It's below our conscious awareness. And this will become even more important as we go throughout this talk. This concept of being unconscious. So let's answer this first question. Why does this occur? What is the root of implicit bias? Part of why we have implicit biases or groups tied to implicit biases is that it has developed evolutionarily. The process underlying bias is a healthy human adaptation. I'm not saying the outcomes of implicit bias, but the reasons why we have the groups tying implicit bias is that at some point throughout our evolution, this helped us survive. These processes were inherited a long time ago, hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And this is tied to our response, inherent response mechanisms. So why does this happen? Why do we have these automatic processes tied to our adaptation, provide us, lead us to a better chance of surviving? You all recognize this? So to think about this, you gotta understand the world in which we're living in is very complex and is very complicated. So we're navigating a very complex world, very complicated in the ways in which we're interacting with the world. It's estimated that on average we're we're getting hit with 11 million bits of information every moment. So like every second, that much stimuli in our environments is the information that we're getting hit with. But we're only able to process 40% of that, or not 40%, 40 bits of that information. So we got 11 billion bits that we're getting bombarded with, and we're only able to consciously process 40 bits of that information. So what do we do with that delta, that change in information, which if we're only able to process 40 bits of that information? We develop something known as automatic processing, also referred to as unconscious processing or automatic processing. This allows us to process information unconsciously to deal with that delta. So I often like to think about this is, anyone commute to Johnson State College or maybe to work? Have you ever gotten to your car, you're leaving home, and then the next thing you know, you're at Johnson State, you don't remember how you got there, and all of a sudden you're just there? That's automatic processing. And the reason why we're able to do that is that it frees up our cognitive resources to be able to do other things once we have done something repeatedly. That's an automatic process. So our implicit biases are rooted into this process. So here's another example. Let's take me for example. So as soon as you guys walk into the room and you're looking down at me, your brain already started to engage in automatic processing. And then you began to, let's say you started hashtagging me with different categories. He looks youngish. Hopefully I'm still looking youngish. Professional, hopefully. Hashtag me with that, hashtag is male, hashtag is black. And so this, you can think of this as data. And when you're processing, or when your mind is automatically hashtagging people that you're interacting with, specifically with race and gender, these things happen in a matter of milliseconds. It's a split second. So all those people who say they don't see color, the brain automatically already processed color. So hate to break it to you, if you do see color, but these are primary categories, right? And so when your mind is automatically engaging in this hashtagging, what happens with this data? It gets stored in a mental cloud. So that the cloud on your other data that has been hashtagged as black that you've been accumulating over your entire duration of your entire life. So these images are here because these are images that have also been associated with hashtag as black throughout the course of your life. That's what happens when you automatically engage the process outside of your brain. And so to talk about this in a way to bring it back to social psychology, bring from the hashtag, mental cloud, iPhone analogies, social psychologists will refer to this process as attitudes or stereotypes. So this data that is up in this mental cloud is either attitude or affect or stereotype. What's affect? What's an attitude? This is a gut feeling. It's like that instinct, that gut feeling. This is emotional valences such as positive versus negative, feeling safe versus feeling threatened. That is what we mean when we talk about attitude and affect. A stereotype, on the other hand, is a trait or a belief. And for example, there's traits and beliefs associated with the category. So once you put me in the category black, again, this is an automatic process, more likely than not, more likely than not, I've had some sort of interaction with the criminal justice system. More likely than not, once I've been categorized as black, I was probably a standout basketball player during high school. More likely than not, I one time had aspirations to become the next hip-hop artist, something like Chance the Rapper, so on and so forth. I will say that one of these is actually true, but we can address that at a later time. And so if these things are happening automatically in an unconscious manner, the next question is, how do we know this? We can't we see it. We're not asking individuals to tell us this. Oftentimes, they probably won't tell us this anyway or can't even tap into it because it's an automatic processing happening in a matter of milliseconds. So how do we measure implicit bias? We have some high technological device, something you might see in an episode of Black Mirror that taps into people's brains. No, not yet. Probably coming. But no, social psychologists have designed other ways to tap into our unconscious implicit biases. So to help us understand how this is, I'm going to need some crowd participation. This is very simple. The rules are very, very easy. All I'm going to have to do is run down columns 1, 2, and 3 as quickly as possible. You're going to just ignore the letters and shout the colors. So, for example, green, red, purple, green, blue, yellow, blue, red, green, yellow, red, purple. So I'm going to say ready, go, and then collectively, you guys are going to do this next. Ready? Go.
Green, red, purple, green, blue, red, green, yellow, red, purple.
Perfect. All right. So we're going to do this again a second time. Same rules. Just ignore the letters. Focus on the colors. You guys ready?
Yes.
Go.
Green, red, purple, green, blue, red, green, yellow, red, purple.
Nice. Alright, so third time's a charm, same rules, ignore the letters and save the colors, only focus on the colors. Ready? Go.
Green, red, purple, green, blue, red, green, yellow, red, purple.
Alright, you guys are pretty good at this. I've seen this in another, people were slower than molasses, if you say. But you guys actually were pretty good. What usually happens is that this is a lot harder for people to do because the letters aren't matching the color. And so reading is an automatic process. We've done it so much in our lives. And so when people see that color green, they're automatically red. And then they are a lot slower at going through this process, which shows how fast automatic processes are. Try to prevent automatic process, it usually slows people down. But maybe they're doing something different than Johnson. that's the first thing I'm gonna ask you. Can I ever ask whether it's pleasant or unpleasant? The second thing I'm gonna ask you to do is categorize names. You know, categorize these names by race. And so I'm gonna ask you to put it in terms of a name is stereotypically associated with black individuals, or a name stereotypically associated with white people. So here's an example of names that would be stereotypically associated with black people. Again, so just wanna state this. You may very well know some non-black people with these names. I'm by no means suggesting that their mama's name is Ross. By no way. But in our society, these names stereotypically are associated with black people. And so, for example, same thing here. These are names, yeah, maybe they're a little dated. These are the names that are stereotypically associated with white individuals. Same thing here, you may know a lot of non-white individuals. I'm not suggesting their mama's names are probably either, but our society will typically associate these names with white people. So you're gonna categorize again. Words, pleasant, unpleasant, names, black or white. And so how is this gonna work? How are we gonna do this? And so I'm going to, this is gonna be a low-tech version. We did this in the lab, you'd be looking to a computer and it'd be more fine-tuned. We're gonna do a low-tech version because we like to adapt. So what I'm going to need you to do is put your hands on your thighs or feet. Very important to put your own hands on your own thighs. You can laugh, but you'd be surprised. I've done this before. I now feel like I have to say this. So please put your hands. Yes, watch yourself. Please say watch yourself. Put your own hands on your own thighs. And so this is how this is going to work. And you'll understand why you have your hands on your thighs in a second. We're going to do responses by slapping your knees. As either left or unpleasant, right or pleasant. And the second is going to probably sound like a bunch of drunk horses running in here. That's totally normal. Don't get alarmed. And so the words are going to come down the center of the screen, right? It's going to be a list of words. And all you're going to do is read through that list of words and code your responses either pleasant or unpleasant by slapping your knees. I want you to do this as fast as possible. If you make a mistake, go back, correct it, and then come back down to the list of words. And so, like I said, it's a low-tech version. So when you're done, last thing I need to add is that I'm going to be timing. Yes. And so how am I going to do this with a collective group? We're going to get a collective time. So when 80% of the group is done, now be your time for that trial and collect. So when you're done, just raise your hand. So when you're done, slap your knees, raise your hand. I'm going to look. Oh. Not yet. Good. See, you already followed directions. I like Johnson's Steaks. When you're done, slap your hand on your knees, just raise your hand, and I'll record your time. So you guys understand this?
Yes.
Nice.
not bad, not bad.
13.6
Alright, now it's about to get a little harder. Well, makes it interesting. It's gonna be a little harder. We're gonna combine trials now. So you're gonna be categorizing both name and word. Okay, so this is what you guys are gonna do. Both names and words, same concept, but you're judging both words and names. This side is gonna be left side, unpleasant arm black name, right side arm white name. Are you guys ready?
Complex
explanation.
another possible explanation? This point that maybe researchers have thought about that switching. White campus. I did grad school at Tufts University, also predominantly white campus. And so I always raise this question, but Johnson State College was a historically black college university. 89% of the people sitting in the audience was black. What were the expected results to be? Would they be the reverse effects? Would they expect to have a higher association, positive association with blackness and negative association with whiteness? We expect to see the same effects that we saw in the space, or we expect to see something different?
Same
effects. I guess put your hands when you think we see the same effects. Okay, anyone? Reverse? Okay. So, yes, most of you are correct that you see the same effects, but there is some slight differences. So when they have data on black participants doing the same sort of demonstration, they often show no preference either for pro or black, but the data suggests at least 30% or more participants that are African American actually show the same effect, which is basically pro-white, anti-black bias. So why is that? We'll explain that by addressing the second question. And so what we just did here was a low-tech version of something known as implicit association test, IAT for short, colloquially known as IAT. You can go on this website, Project Implicit at Harvard University, and you can run yourself through a number of different implicit association tests. One's based on race, gender, sexual orientation, so on and so forth. And then that one would be more controlled with that computer. You'll get your individual data versus the way it is collected. That's what we just did, a low-tech version of the IAT. This data I'm presenting you was actually an amalgamation of data from people who have taken the IAT from this website. And as you can see, they have a number of different IATs, like convention, weight, race, age, so on and so forth. I'm going to focus on both the race and the weapons IAT, just because that's the topic of today's talk. And we can see here, over 700,000 people attending this same test that basically you guys did. And this was in 2007, so 10 years later, this number surpasses a million. So over a million people have taken this IAT, and you see a similar result. I think that number is up to 70% now. 70% of the people taking this IAT show this pro-white, anti-black bias in these associations. And we have it specifically looking at weapons. Far less people have taken it still. I'm thinking at least now, 10 years later, that number is over 100,000. We see that 72% of people taking that IAT have an implicit association with black people and threatening weapons, such as guns and knives. So this is just showing the perversive nature of these implicit associations. So what type of lessons can we take from this quick example on how we measure these biases? One is that social category-based associations are pervasive. So social category in this case would be category black. Very pervasive in our society. Over a million people have taken it, over 70% have a similar result that we saw in this space. They can be unconscious and they persist even when we don't want them to. So I spent a little time here at Johnson State College, interacting with students, faculty, and staff. I would go on a limb to say that the majority of the people that I met probably harbor egalitarian, non-presidential attitudes. Even with that, you still see that the majority of the people in this room hold this unconscious association, regardless of how egalitarian that we think we are, or actually really believe ourselves to be. Like, we may hold these attitudes covertly, but unconsciously we still are affected by these associations. And lastly, they can influence judgment and behavior. Now, there's an aspect here where there is an ongoing debate, specifically with the IAT, on whether or not how likely it is to predict behavior. At the very least, though, during this demonstration, if you walk out of this room with nothing else, you'll know that the implicit associations that you have with blackness and unpleasant words affects how fast you slap things. At the very minimum, you know that it's affected how fast you predict that association. But there is a number of recent articles showing that it can predict other behaviors as well. So that kind of answers the question, the first question. The roots, what's it rooted in, and how we even measure something that is unconscious what's the cause of implicit racial bias? And I think this is important because the root of implicit bias may have been adaptive, but there's nothing adaptive about associating black individuals with us. There's nothing adaptive associating black individuals with freedom. And so this has primarily developed because of the culture of the United States. So I situate implicit racial bias in a broader context of white supremacy. I know this word is kind of very alarming to individuals, so I like to break this word down, because colloquially, when we think of white supremacy, we think about clowns running around in sheets running across them with black swans. We think about people who are skinhead with Aryan Nation, with swastikas tattooed on their chest. And although those are white supremacist individuals who are conscious, when critical race theorists and other academics talk about white supremacy, we're referring to something more broader. Lastly, it's manifest. invite the disciples to come. And the example of Jesus Christ. Hello? So although there's no scholarly agreement on Jesus Christ's exact physical appearance, the most widely disseminated images of him in the U.S. but elsewhere is the unfavorably depicted as a white man. So this is the most common image of Jesus Christ that we see, although there's no scholarly agreement on what he actually looked like or if he actually existed. I think that's another conversation. And so because of this, since the Christian accounts are that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and I think in Catholicism and Protestantism, he is the human form of God, many researchers and theorists have argued that because of Christian accounts of Jesus being the Son of God, of an all-knowing, all-powerful God, white portrayals of Jesus Christ not only symbolize white supremacy, ideological white supremacy, but also reinforce this ideology. Again, the beliefs of white superiority, black inferiority, functions on a conscious and unconscious level through repeated exposure. No one has to be stating this explicitly, but you're associating godliness with whiteness when you have white material in Jesus Christ. And because of this, theorists have argued that this may contribute to anti-black attitudes. And so, in my own research, I decided to test these theories that people were the arguments and assumptions that people were making. So my own research, In this case, which we're talking about, had white individuals come into the lab and I exposed them subliminally, so this is outside their conscious awareness, with four different images, two of which were related to religiosity. One image was an image of white Jesus, so when people, first condition, were exposed to images of white Christ. The other religious object or image they were seeing was a church. So they're both ties to Christianity, but one is a portrayal of a supernatural agent. White, the other is a church, which is an added object. The other condition was a white male, which also Jesus Christ is a white male, except there's qualitative differences between a white male, which is a generic white male, versus a white male who's portrayed as a god or a son of God. And then I had a neutral non-religious condition, and this is what I found. So after white individuals had been primed or exposed to images of a white Christ, we saw an increase in their anti-black attitude. So the same demonstration that we did here, in the IAT demonstration that we just did, I had participants do that same exercise to their computer after they had been exposed to images. So one way to think about it is that their baseline anti-black attitudes basically increased after being exposed to images of white Christ. As I said, white supremacy is not a code word for white individuals. I ran the same exact study with black individuals. Same methodology, same design, and we see the same pattern of results. After black individuals were exposed to images of a white Christ, this increased their anti-black associations and pro-white associations, as measured by the same sort of design or demonstration that we did in the car in this city. So this was just to illustrate why I situate implicit racial bias in a broader context of white supremacy. Not all researchers do that, but I think there's a growing push for us to do that. Or I think they do that, but if white supremacy is too much of a loaded word for some individuals, and I know it is, they'll say cultural racism, which is basically saying the same thing without naming the system. So if you want to water it down, depending on what audience you're talking to, say cultural racism, because some people aren't ready to tackle and interact with that. So we talked about the roots, we talked about the causes, now we want to dive into does this implicit bias impact. So what are the consequences? So implicit biases do matter. So just to sum that up quickly, there's a mountain of evidence in social psychology that has shown how implicit biases impact employment, education, criminal justice, health, politics, and a number of other sub-areas as well. I'm going to just highlight the first three because I could be here all day going through study after study after study, illustrating how laboratory. This was done in the real world. These resumes were sent to Boston, Chicago, and this is what the results were found. So implicit biases affect or impact people's employment prospects. There's a follow-up study done with a similar paradigm that wanted to look at the impact of criminal records on people's employment outcome. Because with the criminal record, you can legally be discriminated, right? You can use that to not hire someone or want to call them back. So they want to see how much does that impact people's employment prospects. And what they found here was interesting to look at this is the bars here, no criminal record. You know, the black individual's bar is 14%. A white individual with the record is at 17%. I think that's what the most striking data here in this graph is illustrating. So a black individual with no record has less of a chance of getting a call back than a white individual with a felon. So another way to think about that is like simply by just having black skin existing in the United States, your body is criminalized as soon as that doesn't have a felon. It is existing is a felony offense. One way to kind of interpret that. I'll give the question to Adam. So what about education? So education, this is something I just pulled up, I think around our friend shared it maybe a month ago, but it's been around since 2016. This is despite the same test scores, whites more likely than blacks enter MST programs. Again, this was an experiment done in class or in a laboratory design. This was pulled from real data. So these black students are doing everything quote unquote right, and yet the educational prospects are being harmed because of implicit racial biases. So they have the same exact test scores as white counterparts, but yet they're not being placed in different education programs when they may suggest that they should, which would then lead to a number of different positive outcomes that are associated with education. One of those also being employment prospects, or maybe getting into highly selective schools. That's education. Another one, which is the three that I picked are sort of all related. This has to do with suspensions. So the way in which suspensions are being handed out, particularly with black boys, but also with black girls, also is influenced by race. There was a study that recently came out too that used teachers as participants, and they had students and teachers read report of a student who had been talking back in class or was coming too late to class, and the students with the black sounding names, Darnell, Tyrone, these students were more likely to be labeled as troublemakers, even though the offenses were exactly the same, also more likely to be recommended to be suspended in the future, which also matched on very well to the data that was collected from the Department of Education. Lastly, question as far as how this as real world education doesn't matter, criminal justice system. I could have just devoted my whole talk to just this subarea. This is just looking at shooter bias, which is called in social psychology. And this showed that, and these participants were police officers. Again, so the ones who've been trained were so in the same society. When there was an unarmed target during the simulation, target was more likely to be shot. The error rate was higher than with the white individual. And you see here, when the individuals are actually are armed, white individuals are getting what they would refer to as more leeway. So that they're not as quick to shoot an armed white target relative to black people. Like I said, there's a number of different things I could have put into. To note that with all these situations, argument can be made that these individuals aren't doing this intentionally. We often get caught up in that conversation. Oh, this wasn't intentional. And then I push back, it doesn't matter if the outcome's the same. cop racist, you get caught up in that conversation. I don't care if that cop is racist. Well, I do care. But I don't care if that cop was racist if Mike Brown is still there. And so did race play an issue? The data overwhelmingly suggests yes. The ambiguity across real life situations that we didn't have a controlled laboratory study to minimize all these other variables that point in that direction. But overwhelmingly, the data suggests that race does play an issue in how much one reacts, especially in split second decision-making, like somebody's a shooter. So what can we do about this? First and foremost, I'm thinking long term. I'm working at long term, short term. The first thing I think, at least looking at long term, is that you need to dismantle white supremacy. Ideological white supremacy has to be dismantled. How do you go about doing that? I have no idea. So I just say that because I think that is something that we should continue to strive for, but the ways in which to go about doing it, I don't have an answer. Secondly, if I did have the answer, because I'm being recorded right now, I know the history of the United States, I don't even think I will say it on camera. But in the short term, there are some things that we can do. So I think while we're working in tangent with the long term, what can you do in the short term as we're figuring that out? One is mind your bias. This is the title of the next talk, right? And the way, only way in which you can do that is through awareness and education. And this is a first step. So part of the reason these things happen is people deny it. We saw it here. It was anything but race, right? Race and the association with anti-blackness and pro-whiteness wasn't it. It was some other plausible explanation. So we got to mind our own biases, and we have to get more awareness and education. We got to keep this conversation going. This can't be Dr. Howard comes in, Barbara E. Murphy fellow has this one talk during this one day in March, and that's it. This conversation has to be ongoing. Again, tied to this, which I didn't mention, is that people have to be motivated as well. If people aren't motivated to do these things, then you're not going to get them to try to introduce some software and start education. So I would say, get with other people who are also motivated. Don't spend your energy trying to motivate people who are just so resistant to trying to change anyway. I would say don't focus your energy on those individuals. And then two, engage in controlled thinking when making decisions involving stigmatized individuals. So this is like even just beyond race. Anytime you're engaging in any sort of decision making or some sort of process, you try to think about that consciously because it's very easy automatic processes to be at play if you're not. So just noticing race doesn't mean being racist, which I think is a reason why many people adopt like a colorblind ideology and say things like they don't, like, oh, I don't see color. We know that's impossible. We notice it in a matter of seconds. And by acknowledging race doesn't mean being racist. So I think these are some things that we can do in the short term. And that's all I have for today. I'll take some questions.
Yeah.
Maybe. Often, we know this from data as well, is biases. There's been tons, like at least the last 2 years, on how we change because of black people. And so they ran like a competition and had all these labs across the U.S. trying to come up with this way to kind of get rid of implicit bias. Long story short, not great. Most of them failed. All of them, they did see some change, but it wasn't long lasting. And so
yeah, I was like,